Education Society. It's a gem you don't really want to tell many people about. I think it's so personal to everyone that hears it. Walter,
remember when the world was young? He was somehow able to fuse together all these different styles of music and points of view. People take pictures of the
summer. It's a romance of England that's in the details. It's not in the big stuff, it's in the little stuff.
That is easily one of the top three albums you have to have. Johnny Thunder lives on
water, feeds on land. It pretty much encapsulates all that I like about England.
Whether it's the real England or an imagined one, it doesn't really matter too much because it's art.
We made an album about childhood friends and characters we knew when we were growing up. The band have played great, and the record is going down well with everyone who hears it. Thing is, the record companies want us to be a singles band, not want to make a thematic album about lost youth and innocence on the village green. So, things don't work out, this could be the last record we ever make. Time will tell, I guess. So, we'll have to wait and see what happens, won't we?
Totally unbelievable, really. It seemed like everything you did was in the newspapers. And it was really, it's like something like caught fire. All of a sudden, you're surrounded by girls, because I was only like 16, 15, 16. They were women and girls. And it was really extraordinary.
We used to do a lot of theatres, and they'd all be sitting there screaming. But I never thought I'd experience it, but I did.
The Kinks!
Going to America, I thought this is going to be like Nirvana for me. It's going to be like heaven. And I was actually quite disappointed because these Americans seemed to be a little bit out of touch and stuck in the 50s a bit. You know, I was waiting to hear all the great blues players, and where were they? Girl, I want to be with you all
of the time, all day and all of the night. In those days, it was like four singles a year and an album, two EPs, four-track EPs. So the pressure was always on.
Luckily, we were a very prolific band, and Ray's really starting to become a prolific writer. And it used to be relentless. You'd go in a studio and record a single a day. And write, set, next.
You know, I'm uncomfortable being a so-called pop celebrity. I don't want to play that game. I just want to write songs about things I care about. That we're a working-class band celebrating being British, and I don't know if America always understands that aspect of the Kinks. Also, our managers are in a legal dispute with each other, and it's creating tension within the group. I've got a distinct feeling something bad's going to happen.
We went over there, got thrown in the deep end a bit, and then things went wrong. The union trouble, and we did things we weren't supposed to do. Won't you tell me, where have all the good times gone? Where have all the good times gone? All got into a bit of a hot-headed sort of argument. Got a bit physical at one time.
America cut us off, really, from our, in our prime, in many respects.
Why were you banned?
A series of things, I think. Fist fight, union dispute, badly managed.
There's a side of America that's extremely conservative and resents anybody else coming over and beating them at their own game, which is what the British groups were doing. There were visa problems for a lot of British groups during that period. You know, the American Musicians Union was very, very obstructive, so I'm sure that was probably a major part of it.
America was a source of all my musical inspiration, so he felt cheated.
It never really bothered me, because it's kind of, I'd rather be at home anyway.
Since we've been banned from touring America, everyone says we should sing our new songs with American accents to broaden their appeal, but to me it wouldn't suit the material. But don't get me wrong, it was American music that first inspired me to become a musician, but I'm a working class Londoner and I can't pretend to be otherwise. So from now on, I'm singing about where I come from, about people that I know, and in my own accent.
'Cause he gets up in the morning, and he goes to work at 9, and he comes back home at 5:30, gets the same...
And I think when Ray Davis just decided to, like, stop pursuing the kind of R&B, the American thing, and drop the accent a little bit, they did turn more introspective, more English.
Everybody in the mid-60s had to sound American. If you didn't sound American, you weren't dealing in the correct currency. Or, sorry, we don't take Scottish pens or whatever it was, you know. You just couldn't get arrested. And so everybody had smatterings of R&B and the blues and the rock and roll and that sort of stuff. But then the Kinks hit this huge seam of Englishness and... Waha, it gelled. It just took off.
Ian Hunter from What the Hoopoo said, when they asked him, why have you written All the Way to Memphis? He said, well, I can hardly write all the way to Walthamstow. But in fact, Ray Davis did write all the way to Walthamstow, and indeed Willesden Green and beyond.
So healthy in his body and his mind. He's a well-respected man about town, doing the best thing so conservatively. While his father pulls a maid, and she stirs a tea with councillors while discussing foreign trade. And she,
because we were banned from touring America, I decided to become British and look at where I'm from, write songs about the place where I grew up. And nobody was doing that.
You have the Quiet Kinks EP, which is the first of Ray's social comment songs, which is a well-respected man, and suddenly he finds a new avenue, a very fertile path to go down.
Kind of having a dig at the middle classes, really. I thought there was an element of people thought that was just very cynical, really, of Ray, you know. But they're all valid, very valid points to be made, really, you know. The old establishment was still there running things. It might have been swinging, but the same systems were still in place.
We made a huge impression with our blues invasion over in the States. But really underneath all of that, there is Harry Champion, Noel Coward, Max Miller, and there's this sort of music and these sort of songs.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I'll make that do. If I don't work fast tonight, please forgive me, I'm very tired. I've been shoplifting. And some of those shops are very heavy, I tell you.
People like Max Miller, and all these great, wonderful characters. George Formley with this interesting, quirky, eccentric Englishness about them. It was wonderful to discover it all on our own land. You know, and although I was wanted to grow up being Eddie Cochran, there was also this background or backstory of music that was our own, that was English.
In England, I feel like was really focusing in on a lot of the American sound and, you know, the American blues and rhythm and blues and stuff like that. You find Ray just kind of going for these, like, almost old-fashioned you know, references and songs, you know, that their parents were listening to.
When you read about their Saturday night parties and all that stuff around their house and everyone's singing and everyone doing a song on the turn, that's all fed into that music, really.
It's a great big shame, and if she belonged to me, I'd let her know who's who. Nagging at a fellow who is 6'3".
You're only 4'2". Not a month nor more, when underneath her fun goes Jim. How isn't it a pity as the likes of her should part upon the likes of him?
''66 was the year when mod began to become rock, began to become psychedelia. The influence of drugs was beginning to percolate into mainstream white music. You're starting to get more complicated, more urgent, more compressed, a lot of ideas still being compressed into the 2 to 3 minute single, an incredibly fertile time. In a way, Ray Davies and the Kinks found themselves in the middle of it because he was able to tap into the various moods with three extraordinary singles that year. And they really are among his best work, which are Dead End Street, Sunny Afternoon, and Dedicated Follow Fashion.
They seek him here, they seek him there. His clothes are loud, but never square. It will make or break him, so he's got to buy the best, 'cause he's a dedicated follower of fashion.
I learned very early on the best way to attack somebody is with humour or make a statement. You can't just be angry at things. Dedicated follower of fashion came out of a falling out with the clothes designer who accused me of wearing flares. Anyway, I was wearing tapered trousers. And he said, you're going to end up wearing flares. I said, get out of my house at the party. It's my party and I'll cry if I want to. And I went, instead of having a fight, I went straight to my typewriter and typed out Dedicated Follow Fashion. Word, didn't have to change a word.
Humour. The silliest things that he might think of that probably to anybody else are totally unfunny. But I kind of, oh yeah, big laugh. And it is that connection, I think, that's really helped Kinks music.
When you're in a band with a family member, that can be the band's greatest strength, but it's also the band's greatest weakness. But the thing that brothers have when they're singing together is there's nothing like two family members singing together.
When he pulls his frilly nylon and his raked up tight, he feels a dedicated follower of fashion. Oh, yes, he is.
Oh, yes, he is.
Oh, yes, he is.
Oh, yes, he is.
Every schoolboy sang that. You know, we'd be bellowing it over the playground. Oh, yes, he is. You know, it became a huge catchphrase. It plugged straight into the English music hall psyche.
You've got a very dangerous sort of precipice of novelty. You know, it's very easy to fall into novelty. But to walk that line is a really marvellous thing.
Everyone's talking about swinging London, but as far as I'm concerned, it's a diversion, a form of escape. I can't help feeling that something, a time, is coming to an end. There are more important things going on in the world, so I've decided to stay home, sing for my fans, get the message across through the music.
Sport was my only way before songwriting of associating with the world. And when we got Germany in the final, of course, it was the old rivalry again.
It was amazing, because we didn't really think we had the team to win, really.
Racing to beat the whistle, Jeff Hurst saw an opening in the defence and achieved the hat-trick.
I actually wanted everything to end there, because it just doesn't get any better than that winning the World Cup.
I learned a lot from football. And Ray was good at football also. It helps the music as well because, you know, you can't just play all the way through. You know, when you're in a team, it's a give and take and emphasis, and you've got to kind of think in a different way. So, I mean, music is often about when and not to do things.
We're a team. Everything, all the rivalry is cast aside because that was our common denominator. And it was just magical, really. We were touring, recording, and living together, fighting together, love and hate. All the emotions were there, and it just came through. Playing was a good part.
The taxman's taken all my dough and left me in my stately home, blazing on a sunny afternoon.
To actually get a number one and the British football team winning the World Cup, that was wonderful.
Sunny afternoon was great. I remember Ray finding me out. He said, come and have a listen. And he starts this dissenting line on the piano. And it's incredible. And you look back and you get those vibes, those moments, those positive feelings. And you're doing something right.
That makes me think of Philip Larkin. It makes me think of John Betjeman, some of those very, you know, well-established English poets. But I also think it's a very underrated craft. You know, I think it's easier almost to write abstraction than it is to write rhyming couplets that tell a story. And more often than not, end up being with, you know, it's me as well, you know what I mean? It's not like I'm slagging you off.
Telling tales of drunkenness and cruelty.
I loved his cynicism, and I loved his this kind of wry sense of humor, but at the same time, there was this earnestness, and there was this dichotomy that was always seemed to be going on in his voice.
Help me, help me, help me sail away.
He influenced a lot of people in pop music at that time, especially English bands. Certainly the Rolling Stones did. The Rolling Stones did at least two or three songs that were overtly Kinks-like. Mother's Little Helper, that's like ersatz Kinks. The Kinks influence went everywhere.
I have a feeling that underneath all the fashion and glamour, society seems to be struggling. I wouldn't exactly say it's falling apart, but there's poverty, unemployment, homelessness, just like my dad used to tell me about the Great Depression. But the world keeps on rocking regardless, so I'm going to keep writing songs about it.
There's a crack up in the ceiling, and the kitchen sink.
From celebrating the boom with dedicated follow fashion in a kind of ironic way, to catching the downturn with Sunny Afternoon, with Dead End Street, you actually have this empathy for the poor and the downtrodden.
His gift of melody and just the subject matter he was writing about, no one else was really covering that, you know. With something like Dead End Street, no one was really writing about that. The other side of England, you know, everything was swinging, you know, apparently, swinging London. But there were still, you know, there were still many, many poor people.
England won the World Cup, everyone was ebullient, really jumping around, waving the flag. And quite rightly so, it was a great time. But underneath it, there was this hard Labour government and decisions were being made. There's a crack up in the ceiling, the kitchen sink. It's kind of metaphorical in many respects. Was called Liverpool Sunset because it was about the demise of Merseybeat. But Waterloo's always been an important place, a still get a buzz when I go down there.
It's totally and utterly human. It's a small observation of a big scene.
I'd say Waterloo Sunset's my favorite pop song of all time, bar none.
It's a hugely romantic song, isn't it? You know, Waterloo Sunset, it's got everything.
It gives me this feeling of comfort in an alienating world.
I do believe Ray Davies is a musical genius. I think to be of such a young age and to write consistently brilliant singles as he did for a good old stretch as well, for a long time as well, from like 64 up until, for me anyway, up to like 71, kind of, I don't know if it gets too much better than that in terms of songwriting anyway.
Many a times I've been writing songs and put the Kinks on for a bit of inspiration and just put the pen down and gone, fuck it, no point. It's already been done.
Yeah, I'm still writing popular songs, but everything else is turning upside down. If we lose this court case, we could become bankrupt. My family's breaking apart too. My older sister Rosie's emigrating to Australia and other members of the family are moving out of London. I need an emotional refuge. A place to escape. Somewhere I can keep my memories intact. From the
I have spent my entire career chasing that song, trying to write a song as good as Autumn Almanac, something that had these little miniature movements, like a little tiny symphony, little parts of a clock that interconnected. And I've chased it since then. How does one write a song as perfect as that?
One of the high points, I think, in terms of its complexity, yeah, and yet its simplicity. And you think about writing a song about Sunday roast and football and all that, it could sound so cliched and sentimental, but it just isn't, because it always has that kind of melancholic kind of undertone. I like my football on a Saturday, roast beef on Sundays. All right, I go to Blackpool for my holiday, sit in the open sunlight.
Ray doesn't just sit down with a guitar and sing it. It's, yeah, it's got different parts he's working on, and it doesn't really tell you what it's all about at all. And then the vocal goes on, and it comes alive, and you think, oh, that's how it sounds.
The Kinks, you know, they did get off the radar in America. It's unfortunate that, you know, people missed out in America on this great music, I feel like, you know, and it became, you know, more British sounding. So, you know, it was a very particular sound palette that maybe America wasn't used to hearing.
1968 is the year when it all comes down, in that there's, you know, the Czech Spring, there's increased demonstrations against Vietnam in America, there's Grosvenor Square demo in London that the Rolling Stones wrote Street Fighting Man about. So suddenly you're into an even more polarized time. And musically the same, the trends of 67 continue, and now there's almost a complete split between chart music, underground music. And underground music moves from psychedelia into hard rock, the start of country rock. Suddenly, it all becomes a bit doer. So it's a very, very serious year. In the parlance of the time, it's very heavy.
The world seems so chaotic. I want to make an album about things that matter to me. This church is just down the road from where I used to live. I want to celebrate where I grew up and my parents' generation. write something they could sing in a church or down the pub. I long for a more innocent time. My school choir sang in this church. All my sisters got married here. Sometimes I think hymns have been replaced by pop songs. It was always my ambition to write a song for the school assembly, set aside the anger and the bitterness of the times, create my own dreamscape, my own village green.
Country, far from all the soot and noise of the city, there's a village green. It's been a long time since I last set eyes on the church with the steeple down by the village green.
Village green is about innocence, the time when things could have been different, that pivotal moment in your life when who went on to become an adult.
Village Green is a perfect example of Ray conjuring out these new characters that are based on real people. So, which, you know, it's a wonderful thing to be able to do. It's like painting.
Village Green is special for everybody. Everybody's got their own version of it, I think.
Often that an album works as a collection of tracks just on their own and then as an album as well. They're rare, those records.
Love the production on it, the songs, the melodies, Ray's voice. I love the fact it wasn't overblown. It's intimate, it's beautiful, there's the sadness to it all.
It pretty much encapsulates all that I like about England. I was brought up in London. I feel myself as a Londoner. I find it very difficult to grasp what England really means. So I would suggest, if I had to, that album would be what I feel England means.
It's a great snapshot of England. Whether that's the real England or an imagined one, it doesn't really matter too much because it's art and you can make of it whatever you want.
I think it's the same place that, George Orwell talks about when he talks about the air is different in England when you arrive back here. The coins are heavier. The beer is bitterer. It's a romance of England. It's a romance of England that's in the details. It's not in the big stuff. It's in the little stuff. It's in the little collection box shaped like a lifeboat in the pub.
Ray started to carve these lovely, this lovely poetry, really, about these people that we knew but didn't know. You know, I love that mystery. They really, I mean, it reminds me of Sound Serpent. You know, I think that's when it kind of hit home what a beautiful, romantic concept it was.
Muswell Hill is a village within the city, so, and the community was important, although I didn't think so at the time. You know, you've got the church, opposite you've got the cinema, which used to be called the Odeon, and opposite there's a dance hall, which is now Sainsbury's. So within that roundabout was all our cultural experience.
Race writing is drawn from real people that we knew or knew of. And a lot of these characters, I think, became characters in songs.
The countryside symbolised me, freedom from the city. So the countryside represented the adventures that you don't speak about in London. The secret world, the secret people.
Picture book is really important for many reasons. That family unity thing. Me and Ray always worked best when we did the octave vocal thing.
Mick Avery is playing the drums and the snare drum has no snare, you know, the snares are not on, so you hear this kind of thud on the snare drum, and then mixed with the 12-string guitar, it's a sound I really haven't heard on any other record.
Gives it a different sound, so it seemed to work on that number, I don't know why.
Mick Avery's drumming on the whole album, I think he's like my favourite drummer. He's just got the, you know, whether he knows it or not, he's just got such a great flair for and feeling for the drum rolls, you know. And I know it's a muso thing, but it's really important within the sound and the songs of the Kinks. I think Mick Avery's brilliant on that album.
And then you have this really interesting sort of circle fifths kind of thing going on with the chords, which is just going up fourth and up a fourth, and then it sort of very cleverly kind of brings you back to the beginning again.
But my family hasn't changed since 1975. And it's full of these faded photographs of parties, of yellow shirts, collars are far too big, and me dressed as a cowboy and my sister with her first acoustic guitar, which I nicked when I was 13.
A lot of the Kinks was, let's get away from modern life. Let's do all those dumpy things. Let's sit in a deck chair. You know, let's have an anky on our head at the seafront at Brighton. My favourite on that album is Do You Remember Walter? What a tune. What a shiver that gives you. Walter, remember when the world was young? Every time I hear it, I think of an old fella with a pipe, and he's thinking about his best pal at the time, Walter. Do you remember Walter playing cricket in the thunder and the rain? Do you remember Walter smoking cigarettes behind your garden gate? There's somebody I pass almost every day in the street, and I'm sure he was my best friend when I was about 7 or 8, but I cannot pluck up the courage to say to him, didn't you used to be? You know, I'm kind of afraid of what he might say. What, he'll only say no, but if he says yes, it'll be like, well, why didn't you say something every time we pass? You know, do you remember Walter digs up a very personal common trope for everybody? Walter. Remember when the world was young and all the girls knew Walter's name? Walter, isn't it a shame the way our little world has changed?
The song is modulating all over the place. The chords are, you know, the key center is changing all the time, but then you have this very sort of memorable melody on top. That's almost like a nursery rhyme, and it's just tying it together. The first verse of the song, you have it in C. You have... So now we're in the key of B-flat, E-flat being the 4 of B-flat. Now we're in the 5 of B-flat, which is F. And so we're here, now we've modulated. Now we're going to go to E flat. Now we've modulated to G. Still in G. Now we go to E flat. To see, very cleverly done.
With Water, I always felt very sad when we did it because it reminded me of, like, guys that you got best friends at school and, like, all of a sudden they're not there.
His guitar playing's great on that album. It's like stuff like, do you remember Water? It's he's playing the song, isn't he? Because the songs have changed, the songwriting changed. But he's still got a great sound. He's really melodic, and it comes through. I think his guitar playing's really underrated, Dave Davis. We'd save up all our money and we'd buy a boat and sail away to sea.
But it was not to be. All those memories about people you loved and played with at school. Where are they? Where'd they go? Just an echo of a world I knew so long ago. Walter, if you saw me now, you wouldn't even know my name. I bet you're fat and married, and you're always home in bed and tucked up safe. And if I talked about the old times, you'd just get bored and you'd have nothing left to say. Yes, people often change, but memories of people can remain. You said we'd fight the world so we'd be free. Boink. Small bullshit. Powerful.
Sometimes I have trouble communicating my ideas. That's why I express myself better through songs. I find it easier to do that. Songs allow me to say something serious in a funny way, speak from inside myself so that you can feel happy and sad in the same moment, live in reality and fantasy, the past and the present at the same time. No, it's not nostalgia. It's more like time travel.
You can imagine, you know, Monica, and you can have your own relationship with her. That there is something lovely and romantic about the Village Green and the characters and the foreboding, you know, the age-old thing of don't go into the woods, and weird fat cats in trees, and then beautiful but aloof girls.
Monica was a real person. And unlike the way she's depicted by many people, glamorous, you know, stocking, she was quite a modest girl. In fact, we walked just over there one night, just over by that tennis court, whatever it is. So they're all real people, but I was aware of litigation even in those days, so I changed to turn them into different people.
So I like to paint the way I do because I feel like I'm expressing a lot of what's going on in our subconscious, because it's just as important, probably more important, than our conscious, physical reality, because that's where a lot of this weird shit comes from. But I decided to do a Monica, which is a more abstract, kind of surrealist thing. I love the rhythm and that song, the kind of Latin vibe of it. And I did a bit of stuck up nose and looking down on all these guys at a door and played a few Bob Fort. Money colours every line. You'll never propose, cause money knows you know. She'll turn up her nose and say what a fool you are. Money
purrs. I'd like to add that I walked with Monica, but nothing happened.
Phenomenal Cat is one of the tracks on the record that really stood out to me. I'm a big fan of the Mellotron, and this is the perfect, you know, Mellotron song.
The artists that I find most compelling are the artists that can create a world. He was somehow able to fuse together all these different styles of music and points of view, literary devices, whether it was first person or creating characters and then having them interact.
The voice that is like the fa-la-la-la-la voice in The Phenomenal Cat, which sounds like it's been speeded up slightly, almost like some strange sort of little person from a circus or another sort of elfish character there.
His production on it, to me, is great because it's very honest. It's not really production that gets in the way. And as a producer, you know, that's, to me, you know, one of the goals.
I always loved Ricky Annabella. That's kind of the most scariest and rock and roll of the lot, with that with the buzzing guitars and that incredible drum sound at the beginning.
The subject matter has always fascinated me. Right now, talking about painting, he said maybe we should do a painting for Ricky Annabella. In the end, I was looking for somebody who was really quite alone and sad and angry. Well, of course, I love it because I sing it, and it's quite a raunchy song to sing. I always particularly like singing the bridge, and when I do it live, I put two bridges on it because it seems like that. I think that bridge is so cool, it should have been twice.
It's the most impudent album. Dangerous isn't the right word, but I just knew it was risky putting it out.
It's just a really dark sounding track, which again, I think, is the skills of Dave Davis, you know, to create that the aura of that track.
The great artist Ray is. I'm sure you might be paying him one compliment. And it's like painting, you know, these people appear out of the invisible.
I had a band from America called The Turtles. They had big hits with Happy Together. They phoned me up where I was living and said, we want you to produce our next album. I said, why? Because you produced Village Green. I said, yeah, but you've just had a big success and I can only offer you failure. They said, we want that danger and that kind of amount of risk-taking. He took risks. I think more than anything else, that's important.
Big Sky. Big Sky is such a great song.
I love it. The whole magic of Big Sky and the way Ray sings it, quite like scared. No, it's scared of the universe, almost.
I think Big Sky is really futuristic. And I think if it was written today, I think it's a really great lyric delivered in, you know, the speech.
It's the first song I'd ever heard that had no singing in it, but it was just talking. You know, it was just this monologue about, you know, all the people looking up at the big sky and the big sky looks down at Peter. I was just like, what? You know, you couldn't sing along to it. You know, it was like I don't know what the musical term is for that thing, but Damon did it in Part Life. Ian Jory used to do it all the time.
Big sky looked down on all the people looking up at the big sky. Everybody's pushing one another around. The big sky feels sad when you see the children scream and cry. But the big sky too big to let it get him down.
He's sort of addressing it almost like a vicar. Big sky, da 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 da. He's got that kind of tone going on in the, you know, big sky, we're all talking to you now, big sky.
I suppose he's Ray writing about God. I don't know. I guess anyway, that's what I always assumed. Looking down on all these little people and not really giving a fuck and not really helping them. That's what I got from it anyway.
Big sky is about an imaginary preacher. Playing it today, it sounds very, with all the Bible bashers on TV, sounds very contemporary.
But then there's the bridge that I always love. One day we'll be free and we're singing harmonies together, and it sounds like, it feels like we're going to get there somehow, be free and happy.
Free from what? Free from religion, free from anything that drives you insane.
Late of Big Sky, the guitar plucking, I think it's a really beautiful part of it. And then it's sort of like a dream state, and then it goes back into the main talking section.
Big Sky looks down on all the people who think they got problems. They get depressed and they hold their heads in their hands and they cry. People lift up their hands and they look up to the big sky. But the big sky is too big to sympathize.
I got the feeling it was our last album. That's why it said this will be about friendship, a magic time, time for reflection, and some funny, dotty characters and some angry characters, Johnny Thunder.
Johnny Thunder lives on.
He's a character I'd like to be. He's kind of the Neil Cassidy, Kerouac.
He's a great character, the person in the song, you know. Rides the highways, you know, doesn't care what anyone else thinks.
Just that the imagery and the lyrics are just, wow, fuck, amazing.
It always reminded me of someone I knew in Oswald Hill, a biker, and he was kind of like, forget his name. But he was out there on his own, his letters and his bike.
Yeah, there were a couple of, he's based on a couple of guys, a couple of heroes. Always got the girl on the back of the bike.
The fact that Johnny Thunder's from New York Dolls must have got his name from it.
Johnny Thunder is just an amazing sound. Ray's voice is, it's hard to put into words. Just the way he sings it, the melody of it is amazing. Mick Avery's drum rolls into the bridge part of it is just beautiful, you know.
Johnny Thunder in particular was always a big favourite of mine. So it's a very varied record. You've got Smokestack Lightning again coming up with Last of the Steam Powered Train.
Like the last of the good old upper train.
It's a celebration of the music that inspired me. It's tipping a hand to Smokestack Lightning by Howlin' Wolf. And that's a different meter and different chords. I'm going to keep rolling. It's about an old rocker who won't give up. I'm going to keep on rolling till my dying day. So there is a sense, it's the most rebellious song on the record.
All those great riffs that we kind of borrowed or tried to copy and fight them up. Because that's how I learned to improvise. Because I wasn't very good at copying. It needs to sound like something else. So I thought, well, let's do it anyway.
It sounded really live. It sounded like you could just walk into a room and the music was happening. At the time, I was listening to a lot of bands from England, like Roxy Music, and I would love David Bowie. And those records seemed a little more pristine, especially the Roxy Music records. And the Kinks records just seemed very live and sloppy. And
Dave, you know, could get a better guitarist to come in and do an overdub, and he wouldn't have the right feel, and it wouldn't have the right attitude that Dave had, because he knew. Knows instinctively what to play.
He's just a great guitar player, as in that he plays the song. And I think that, especially at a time when everyone's getting like groups around like Cream and all, you know, I really didn't care for them. And he's just holding it down over his brother's songs, which I would imagine would have been tricky, you know, knowing what we all do of their relationship. And he's just doing it very humbly and very melodically. And I love him for that.
Dave. Is, I cannot stress enough what a guitarist that guy is, and Ray is a songwriter. So for them to create that sound between the two of them without even thinking about it, I must say something about their genetic makeup.
He's an incredible, memorable guitar player, especially for people like me who didn't want to spend ages, who wanted to just be raw and just play and emote and be expressive. Dave Davis was the man, really. He was doing it. He didn't play like Jimmy Page or Eric Clapton or Hendrix, but they were already doing that. So what's the point?
Whether Ray was metaphorically writing about the Kinks at that time, because they were being very much marginalised by that time, critically and also in terms of success and stuff. And obviously not having the recognition from America, which all his contemporaries were having.
Village Green felt like it was the last record we'd ever make. In fact, it was the last record of the original band with Pete Quaife left. The end of it. And that shot of us standing on Hampstead Heath is one of the last photographs taken together.
We are Village Green Preservation Society. God save Donald Duck, vaudeville and variety. We are the Desperate Dam. God save Strawberry Jam and all the different varieties. Preserving the old way from being abused. Protecting the new way for me and for you. What more can we do?
I love the quintessential Britishness of that song of Village Green Preservation Society. I learned the song probably 40 years ago, but when I learned it, I didn't know what Ray was referring to. Over the years, I've figured out what a George Cross is, and Moriarty, and Miss Mops, and of course, China Cups and Virginity, I could figure out on my own. But I love yes, the Englishness of it all. It makes you feel nostalgic. But by the same token, it still sounds so fresh, even though it was about nostalgia and preserving the past.
The opening track, to me, lyrically, is staggering. I listen to it, often from time to time, and to get all those images to rhyme in that song, it's absurd.
We are the Sherlock Holmes, English-speaking vernacular. Out safe from Manchu, Moriarty and Dracula. We are the office plot, persecution of Philistine. God save the little shops, China cups and virginity.
Ray always just looked at the subject of what was around him and was deconstructing it. But he was also saying, you know, this is progress. Everyone's talking about moving forward. And I think that's a context of what America meant at that time. And he's saying, just before we go, let's just kind of register what is going on around us, even if it's not all perfect. You know, in the Village Green Preservation Society, what is it? Protecting the old ways from being abused, you know, protecting the new ways for me and for you. I think that really sums the whole thing up, yeah.
Although it's not a concept record as such, but it has a certain sort of theme to it, I suppose. A longing and a loss of which things that might not have even really existed, you know.
He was looking back. He was, but in a way, that's kind of revolutionary in itself. It's not necessarily what teens wanted, and it probably annoyed some of them, and all the better for it. You know, if you can't annoy a teenager, who can you annoy?
I think because they wanted it as a single, I was a bit of an upstart. I said, if it's a single, I want British Green not to have any singles on it. Silly thing, because business sense says put this hit single on. So it was a bad choice on my part.
Perfect songwriting, you know, it's like every section to me sounds like it's a chorus, you know, just when you think it's peaked, you kind of get into the next section and then it's almost like that even peaks even more, and I feel like it sort of moves you through the song.
Would have made the album even stronger. The yearning in that song. The yearning and that semitone climb, you know, that ratchets up and then, oh, the release. Great piece of musicianship.
Well, it's just amazing, an amazing tune and such beautiful words as well. And yeah, that's it. It's a classic. Great words, great melody, that's it, that's a great song.
Village Green is an album for friends, a personal record, and to hell with airplay and sales.
Maybe it wasn't just their time, some things don't click to their time, which, you know, it's kind of shocking looking back and seeing how great it still is as an album.
If you look at the context of when it came out, yeah, and everyone's going really wild and freaking out and, yeah, you know, R&B is turning into heavy metal, Led Zeppelin, and, you know, people are throwing their clothes off, and, you know, and then Ray turns up dressed as Max Miller.
The Kinks were out of whack with British tastes in 68. We did want to look to America. I felt more akin
to the Kinks British music hall sensibility.
The Kinks were not forthcoming as characters. If you look back on YouTube and look at their interviews, they don't want to be doing interviews. They don't want to be having the picture taken. They don't want to be talking to anyone. See, the Beatles, they're loving it.
Okay, so the record didn't manage to find an audience. But who knows? Perhaps one day it'll end up connecting with someone. I'm just glad we stood our ground, celebrated this somewhat eccentric land. And as for the Village Green and all those great characters, they're here, in the songs.
People take pictures of the summer, just in case someone thought they had missed it. And to prove that it really existed, fathers take pictures of the mothers, and the sisters take pictures of brothers.
Just the Kinks were an uncool band. We still are very uncool. And which saved us in the end.
If you make a record for an audience, there's always a chance that it will start to lose its luster. If you make a record that is deeply personal to yourself, then, you know, you've created, you know, there's a resonance, there's something genuine in that piece of music.
It's kind of created its own time, really. It doesn't sound psychedelic, it doesn't really sound like the late 60s, it doesn't sound like anything else that was going on around that time. And therefore, I feel it's timeless, really.
It's a cult album, and thankfully, lots of people like it, fond of it.
Well, the Village Green album is one of those records that this has just got this incredible reputation now. And it's deserved, because it is an extraordinary collection of songs.
It's the best Kinks album, Village Green album is, I think, and it's the... And the Kinks are one of the best bands, you know, that England have ever produced.
It's as important a record as Sgt. Pepper's, which on a global scale, of course, is Sgt. Pepper's, and, you know, we all know what that meant, and still means. But The Village Green is, it's for me anyway, it's a sequel.
That's one of the albums that I'll go back to, you know, when, you know, working with different artists, and, you know, sometimes we'll kind of listen the stuff just to kind of, you know, get inspired. And, you know, the Kinks is absolutely, you know, Village Green Preservation Society is one of the ones that, you know, is definitely go to.
Some of the subjects he was writing about, things that would be of no concern to most people, and yet are really beautiful little details that he's spotted and put into a song. So that would be a definite influence on my writing.
It's so obvious that how many musicians love it, because you see it in other songs. It appears in so many other songs. You know, there's a bit on Johnny Thunder which appears in the Crowd by the Jam. There's the beginning of Do You Remember Walter, which whenever I hear Mr. Blue Sky, I go, this is going to be... This, ooh, they've updated this. And then, oh, of course, oh, it's Mr. Blue Sky. So, and that is people paying homage.
The first one that springs to mind is Blur. Not sure Damon would have a career without Ray Davis.
You can see the Kinks, that the thread went forward through us. I think it went forward through people like Blur. And I think you can detect it in a lot of other bands, possibly the Franz Ferdinands, the Kaiser Chiefs. You can see the Kinks thread going on there. I think any band that doesn't try too hard to be American and or international and just allows themselves, if they're from Britain, allows themselves to be British. You can't help but tip your hat in a big way towards the Kinks.
It goes into Ian Dury, goes into us, goes into Blur, Lily Allen, a number of other people. You know, black comedy, but with a bit of kind of going.
Lives in a house, very big house in the country.
They were very similar to Blur in a lot of ways, or Blur were very similar to the Kinks, I should say. They had an incredibly hard-working kind of songwriter, a kind of nutcase on guitar, who invented everything on his instrument. kind of down-to-earth drummer and a sort of groovy, stylish bass player, you know?
Possibly the most Kinks thing we ever did was Respectable Street, which is totally and utterly what I saw out of my window and what the neighbours were banging on the wall every time I put the record player on, or, you know, I'd look at the caravans that people would buy as status symbols and just leave them in their gardens all year long, and then for 1 week they'd disappear for the holiday, you know. And to me, I knew at the time this Uncle Ray would approve of this, you know. Our house in the middle of our street. Our house in the middle of our house, it has a crowd. There's always something happening. And
for me, if I could equate it to my own career, it would be our house. You know, that for us was exactly the same. It was a kind of mythical idea of what house we all would have lived in. Our Rise and Fall album is very similar in that sense, yeah, because it's set around a park, which is Primrose Hill, and it's set around all the characters that we grew up with.
I know that the Kinks influenced Weller greatly and the Jam influenced us greatly. So there's a kind of linear thing there.
It lived with us for a long time, that record, and it still is one of our favourite albums of all time. And so, it, you know, we would go straight from our flats the next day to go recording, and it would rub off, definitely.
The thing with those bands is they're not ashamed of sounding British, singing their own accent, write about subject matter that could happen where they grew up.
Village one, Green Preservation Society.
Oh, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Green Preservation Society. God save Donald Duck, vaudeville and variety. We are the Desperate Dan Appreciation Society. God save strawberry jam and all the different varieties. Preserving the old ways from being abused. Protecting the new ways for me and for you. What more can we do?
I love the man, you know. I love his work and what he's given me and influenced me and so many other people as well, you know, and his work lives on and always will do.
You know, the Kinks have always been sort of an influence on me. You know, I always was drawn to this juxtaposition of this very dark lyric over something that could be sort of very old-fashioned.
He became a character in my life, and I listened to him quite a bit, so... I'm sure he kind of infused me with his style of writing, and I'm sure it was in there somewhere when I started writing my own songs shortly afterward.
One of the greatest things I learned from Ray was that, yeah, just observing what's going on around you and deconstructing it a bit, but still, you know, loving it, you know what I mean, even though it may not be perfect.
I wouldn't be a songwriter if it weren't for the Kinks.
Paul McCartney and Ray Davies are our greatest songwriters.
He has possibly written songs on his own that are better. I'm sorry about this, I'm committing heresy, that are better than Lennon and McCartney. I don't think Lennon and McCartney have ever come up with something as poignant as Waterloo Sunset. I don't think they've ever come up with a little symphony like Autumn Almanac or Shangri-La. I don't think they've ever come up with quite the social commentary of Sunny Afternoon, or the romance of days, and oh, I'm so sorry, but it's got to be said.
I loved being within a band. It wasn't the greatest band in the world, but we had moments when nobody could beat us.
So who knows what the future holds for us, or the Village Green, and all the characters we sang about, All I can say is people often change, but memories of people can remain.
One day we'll be free, we won't care, just you see.